Hey, I'm Chris. This is MMA for you. I'm going to be doing my predictions for UFC Fight Night 88, Almeida versus Garbrandt, which happens on May 29th. But before I get into that, I'd like to plug a group and my own author's website. So the group is UFC Betting Sharks. You can find them off of Facebook. They are a group of MMA fans, experts, expert bettors, analysts and whatnot, that are helping each other pretty much to gather information about fights and fighters and to make like the best bets that can be made in MMA fights. And also they just need analysts and whatnot. If you're interested in joining the group, you have to interview with Mitch Williams. You can also like the UFC Betting Sharks page on Facebook as well. Also, I check out www.chrismoldong.com. I am an aspiring author specializing in the fantasy genre. And you can support my journey of being an author by buying my first novel and a fantasy adventure called The Mustard Prince in the Condiment Kingdom for $8.95 at my website at www.chrismoldong.com. And I actually just put it on Amazon as well. So if you have a Kindle, for example, you can now buy that, buy my story off of Amazon. Also on my website, check out blogs, which are updated weekly, other stories for sale, like short stories and whatnot, free short stories, and the Writer's Talk web series, which is just me talking everything writing. So on this fight card, it's definitely a prospect. I would say it's something of a prospect heavy card, which I like. I mean, you got Adam Milstead at heavyweight prospect. He's only 28. Freaking huge guy too. He looks like, it's like Todd Duffy or something, just totally built. You know, whatnot. Aljamain Sterling's on. And these two guys are on the UFC Fight Pass prelims. Aljamain Sterling, Shane Campbell versus Erik, two prospects. Jake Collier versus Alberto Pereira Uda. Even though Uda's 31 years old, he does fight in a higher weight class at 185, and he's only 9-0, so I would consider him still a prospect. Rinaldi finally joined the UFC. I don't even know if you can consider him in prospect territory anymore. He got a good women's fight in I versus McMann. Paul Felder's a good prospect, even though he's 31. I still consider him a prospect. Lorenz Larkin versus Masvidal, solid fight. Miranda versus Camozzi, I think, is actually going to be pretty good. Middleweight fights, especially in the mid-level, can be a bit iffy, but Miranda has shown to be a pretty good action fighter. Saffiedine, he's, you know, versus Story, solid fight there. Stevens versus Barão, solid fight there. Almeida versus Garbrandt, great prospect fight there. Upset potential does exist in a lot of fights. I don't look at odds. I'm guessing Almeida's a favorite. I can see an argument for Garbrandt. I'd assume that Hendon Barão's a favorite. I would actually look into that fight. I can see Stevens taking that one, actually. I'll give you my reasons why. McMann versus I don't know who the favorite is, but if it's McMann, I'd favor her, but I can see I getting the win there. Sterling versus Caraway. You might think, oh yeah, it's the Funkmaster, Aljamain Sterling. Stylistic matchup isn't the greatest for Aljamain Sterling, I'll tell you this right now. I'll get into that. But it's actually not the best stylistic matchup for Sterling. And you got Milstead versus De La Rocha. Milstead should probably be the favorite, I'm assuming. But it's heavyweight, and it's a guy having his first fight in the UFC who's never passed the second round. So both guys never passed the second round. So it's those ones are always really tough to call because heavyweight is a weird place. Let's get started. Tominas Almeida fights Cody No Love Garbrandt. So this is a five rounder, so take that into consideration as well. So Garbrandt, 8-0, undefeated record, 7 wins by KO or TKO, 1 win by decision, 24 years old. They're both 24 and 5'7". Garbrandt, to my knowledge, even though like certain sites are like shared always saying differently, I believe Garbrandt's still training out of Team Alpha Male primarily. Garbrandt's boxing is really strong. He uses combinations well. He's particularly heavy-handed. He's knocked out his last opponent quite easily, actually. And actually, he's actually a good wrestler. Like I won't even say he may have had a wrestling background, or at least a boxing background. I forgot. He had like some other combat sports background as well. But his wrestling's good, both offensively and defensively. He's also really, in general, he's a really aggressive guy who pushes forward. Almeida, 20-0, undefeated record, 16 wins by KO or TKO, 3 wins by sub. He's 24 years old, 5'7", training out of Shoot the Box and Macaco Gold Team. He is also a strong boxer, but prefers the high volume. He's not a one-punch knockout guy per se, despite the fact that he did get like the flying knee KO over Pickett. And you know, there's the other guy he beat too. I forgot his name now. TriStar knocked him out too. But he's a high-volume striker. He's just a strong body punches as well as strikes to the head. So he uses a lot of combinations. His takedown defense is actually really improving. His ability to get back to his feet is getting real good. The issue with him, though, is that he is a slow starter. The fact that he almost got like finished by Pickett in the first round is not uncommon for him. You can actually check out his regional fights. He actually does not do great in that first round. So that's something to look out for. I have to favor Almeida as far as the long game goes. You know, with five rounds and the pace and volume that Almeida brings, I favor his style. Not to say that Garbrandt's a guy that gasses or something like that, because as far as I can tell, he doesn't. But I think Almeida's just a little more proven as far as being able to maintain a certain high pace, staying on his opponent and whatnot. And I can't really see Garbrandt being able to break that. One thing that does worry me though is the slow start from Almeida. So Cody Garbrandt could very well win in that first round. I think if it goes past the first round, I'm gonna start favoring Almeida more and more. Garbrandt seems is a seemingly tough guy. I can't really see him get finished, and until he has proven otherwise, I'm not gonna call either of these guys to get finished. But I am gonna go Tomas Almeida to win this by decision, being the higher volume striker. He also goes to the body. He's a guy that wears down his opponents, plays the long game a lot better, and that's not to say he's probably gonna get hit. I can also see Almeida getting hit pretty hard. Almeida has also seen he seemingly gets stronger as rounds go on. That's the other thing I like about him too. It's like you can watch him in the second round. It's like, hey, he's doing real good. And third round, it's like, well, he's doing really good. You know, doesn't really stop what he's doing. So I'm gonna go Tomas Almeida win this by decision. Garbrandt's good though. I am pretty high. I'm very high on both of these as prospects. You know, I mean, they're only 24. Heck, Garbrandt only has 8 pro fights. This guy's he's going places. Win or lose, he's going places. Same with Almeida. I mean, win or lose, he's going places. But overall, I'm favoring Tomas Almeida to win by by decision. Next fight after that, Renan Barão fights Jeremy Lohelan Stevens. Stevens, 24-12 record, 16 wins by KO Tico, 3 wins by sub. He also has 3 losses by submission. He's 29 years old. He's 5'9", training out of Alliance. Stand-up is solid. He's a heavy strikes. I mean, this is a guy that can win by head kick, by knee, and by punch. And he has 1 strike knockout power. He has actually, yeah, he has knocked out opponents with a variety of different strikes. His overall grappling is improving, both offensively and defensively. And there's sometimes his takedown defense doesn't look that great, like when he fought Charles Oliveira, for example. But for the most part, if someone shoots from far away, he can, like, defend those takedowns. Takedown defense has gotten a lot better. His chin is solid as well. Renan Barão, 33-3 record with 1 no contest. 8 wins by KO Tico, 15 wins by sub. Has us 2 losses by KO Tico, both by TJ Dillashaw, if I'm not mistaken. 29 years old, he's 5'7", training out of Novo Niao. He is trading losses and wins right now, and a former UFC bantamweight champion, and he is moving up to 145 pounds for this fight. His Muay Thai is really strong. He is actually relatively heavy-handed. I wouldn't say as heavy-handed as, say, Stevens, but yeah, relatively heavy-handed, good overhand right. Like, he was dropping, like, Faber with, like, overhand rights. His leg kicks and kicking game in general is good, too. He has that spinning back kick. He also has a flying knee. His overall knees are good, too. So he has a lot of diversity in his strikes that he uses. His takedown defense is actually, like, I want to say it's the best in the UFC, if I'm not mistaken. I want to even go so far as to say he might have 100% takedown defense or something crazy, like some crazy takedown defense stat. He's a legit Brazilian jiu-jitsu black belt, particularly a good arm triangle like most Novo Uniao guys got. Things that worry me about him, his overall stand-up defense isn't great. He does get lulled into brawls. And he doesn't take a hit well. I'm going to say this right now. I don't think he takes a hit well. Here's the thing. I think Renan Barão is an overall better MMA fighter, just in the diversity that he has. You know, if he gets on top of Stevens, for example, I think he can win. But he's not the greatest wrestler, per se. You know, he doesn't have, like, this supersonic shot or anything like that. Standing, I think he can hit Stevens quite a bit. My only problem is, I think Stevens can actually hit Barão quite a bit. And, you know, I'm not going to just point to the TJ Dillashaw fight here, as far as Barão getting hit a lot. The thing is with Barão, he's flat-footed. The strikers that tend to beat Jeremy Stevens, like Cub Swanson, Mama Glad beat him too, tend to use a lot of movement. And if they don't use a lot of movement, they tried to take him down, like Charles Oliveira, you know, tried to take him down over and over again. But, you know, guys that stand in front of him don't tend to do too well against Stevens. It doesn't help that Barão's going to be the shorter fighter, 5'7", Jeremy Stevens, 5'9". I'll also point to the Mitch Gagnon fight as another fight, which is quite recent for Barão, of a guy that got hit quite a bit. I don't actually know if he's the same guy, too, after the beatings he took from TJ Dillashaw. With that said, I am going to go Jeremy Stevens. I am actually going to go by knockout. There's too many factors here that go against Barão and that don't necessarily favor Barão against Stevens. One, I have seen Barão brawl. Watch the Pickett fight, for example. He'll just kind of throw. He just kind of just throws leather a lot of times during certain times of the fight. Two, he doesn't take a hit well. Three, he's moving up in weight class. Four, Barão doesn't move. He's not a guy that moves. Guys who beat Stevens can generally take him down. Or if it's standing, they generally move really well. Cerrone is another guy too. Cerrone, Gallard, Swanson. Guys that can move relatively well. That won't just stand in front of him. Can play a really, you know, in and out game with him. Can really avoid his strikes. You know, I don't really see Burrell. I can't really think of any defensive skills that Burrell has that can actually defend Jeremy Stephens' strikes very well. You know, I think Burrell might just be the faster guy, and that might help him. And also, he's been on the ground, so if he can take Stephens down, that helps him. Overall, I just think it's a tough stylistic matchup for him. I think Jeremy Stephens also, the size difference might actually prove, size and height difference might actually prove to also be Burrell's undoing as well. Jeremy Stephens, KO or TKO, can see him hitting counters. If he brawls, I can see Stephens getting the better of the brawls. I can also see Stephens hitting Burrell clean and Burrell getting dropped, whereas I can see Burrell hitting Stephens clean and Stephens might not get dropped, you know. So yeah, Jeremy Stephens, KO or TKO. Next fight after that, Tarek Spun Saffiedine fights Rick the Horror Story. Story, 18-8 record, 4 wins by KO or TKO, 4 wins by sub. 31 years old, he's 5'10 on a 2-fight win streak, training out of MMA lab. He's a good wrestler, especially offensively. He's particularly good ground and pound. He's always pushing forward, very aggressive. Stand-up's gotten a lot better, too. Just a little more technical. Yeah, he actually has shown to have a pretty good leg kick these days. And his chin's pretty good, too. Tarek Saffiedine, 16-4 record, 1 win by KO, 5 wins by sub. 29 years old, he's 5'9", and a former Strikeforce welterweight champion. He is a very technical kickboxer. He has really strong leg kicking game. His takedown defense is really good too, and his ability to get back to his feet when he's taken down is, I'd say he's one of probably the best as far as takedown defense and ability to get back to his feet. He might actually be one of the best in the division. His chin though is really questionable. I gotta say, this is a guy, yeah, he got dropped by Ellenberger, which is fine. Ellenberger hits hard. In Strikeforce, he fought that one tall guy. Was it Toner? Was it Tyler Toner? He fought someone and got dropped by him. Warren McDonald managed to TKO him, which is fine. But yeah, and then he got dropped by Hung Yu Lim. I mean, there's some heavy hitting guys that drop him, granted. But the fact of the matter is, he gets dropped, you know? Defensively, though, he is good. Like, there is that one punch that will get in, but for the most part, it's usually like that one punch that gets in. It's not a lot of punches that get in, it's just that one big punch that'll get in. So it's actually kind of tough for me to call, but there's something stylistically I just like about Saffiedine that works well against Story. One, I think Saffiedine can defend his takedowns. Two, I think he's just a better technical striker. Story, I don't think he's a big guy in big for a weight class, but I don't consider him like a heavy hitter per se. It's not to say he's pillar fisted or anything, but I don't really consider him like a one-punch knockout type guy. And actually, his record shows that, too. You know, out of 18 wins, 4 of them are by KO or TKO. You know? He's more of an overwhelming type guy. If he does win, it's overwhelming. And really pushing forward and being the more aggressive fighter. I think Saffiedine's dealt with that. And like I said, I think he's just a better technical striker. More surgical. I can see him landing more strikes on Story than Story can land on him. And Saffiedine can defend the takedowns as well. Rick Story's takedown defense, I think, has been improving over time. But there was a point in his career where he was getting even when he lost fights, he was taken down by just about every guy he's fought. I still gotta wonder if that's still in him. He has a really erect stance. I think that doesn't help his takedown defense. And he's always pushing forward. So I think that allows guys to take him down. Especially in the center of the cage. Maybe not against the cage, but in the center of the cage for sure. And Saffiedine does have that in his back pocket. He actually has a decent offensive takedown game that he can use. So, but I'm going to go Tarec Saffiedine. He's not a finisher. That's the problem with Saffiedine, too. Just not a finisher. Tarec Saffiedine by decision. Next fight after that, Chris Camozzi fights Vitor, Lex Luthor, Miranda. Chris Camozzi, 23-10 record, 7 wins by KO TKO, 7 wins by sub. Has 5 losses by submission. 29 years old, he's 6-3 on a 2-fight win streak. Training out of Factory X Muay Thai. A lot of guys are training out of there now. I know like Brian Rogers, I want to even say Joe Warren trains there. I think that one's a growing camp, actually. It's more than Chris Camozzi. His brother trains there too. His brother's actually pretty good. Camozzi's big for 185, 6'3", and just a big guy. Everything about him is really average, though. Like, he's not a great striker, but he's not a bad striker. His overall grappling game isn't bad, too. He's has a decent front choke series. You know, he can handle himself on the ground. He does have takedown defense. The things that help Camozzi, he's got a really good chin. He's big, and he's tough. He's got a really good chin. Still remember his fight against Lorenz Larkin, where he's just eating power punches. Didn't get finished. And he's just super resilient. Vitor Miranda, 12-4 record, 9 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub. 37 years old, he's 6-1 on a 3-fight win streak. Trains out of Team Noguera. Miranda's got some strong Muay Thai skills, particularly heavy-handed. His takedown defense is really improving, especially against the cage. I believe his last two opponents were trying to take him down against the cage. He defended that. Even got on top at sometimes. Overall grappling game, despite the fact that he's primarily a stand-up guy, his overall grappling game has shown some improvement as of late. Like I said, with his takedown defense and some level of top control now, too. With that said, I like Vitor Miranda here. I actually really like what I'm seeing out of this guy. As of late, he's been impressing me. He just has, he's not, like, super great. I mean, like, yeah, like, you do have to respect his stand-up. And you can't underestimate his grappling, too. Like I said, he can defend takedowns and beat you up. For example, like, last opponent, you know, guy tries to take him down. Doesn't work. He gets a tie clinch. Knees you. You know? It's like, oh, yeah. You know, you got to respect his, like... You got to respect his game. It's not super fearful. It's not like, oh, don't stand with this guy whatsoever. But you do have to respect his game. And opponents seem to be figuring that out. Or haven't figured that out yet. Excuse me. With that said, I like what I see from Vitor Miranda. I think he's a cleaner striker here. If the fight hits, you know, his takedown defense is improving. His overall grappling game looks to be pretty good, too. Vitor Miranda, Camozzi's so freaking tough. He loses by sub, but he's not a guy that will generally lose KO or TKO. And that toughness could actually help him win the fight, too. But I like Vitor Miranda's game here. I'll go by decision, possible KO or TKO. Next fight after that, Lorenz, the Monsoon Larkin, fights Jorge, Gamebred, Masvidal. Larkin, 16-5 record with 1 no contest. 10 wins by KO or TKO, 6 wins by decision. 29 years old. He is 5'11", training out of Millennia MMA. Real unorthodox. This guy will go for spinning strikes, jumping strikes, and whatnot. His overall kickboxing skills are good. He has a particularly strong kicking game, but really good leg kicking game, too. Showed that against Albert Tumanov. Really diversified leg kick game, too. Went for spinning back kicks to the leg. He's pretty heavy-handed, too, you know. His takedown defense is actually pretty solid as well. Jorge Masvidal, 29-10 record, 11 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub. He also has 2 losses by submission, 31 years old, 5'11", training out of ATT. He's trading losses and wins right now. He has a strong takedown defense, really good counter wrestling. Once you take him down, if you can take him down, he's hard to keep down. His stand-up's good. I like his boxing more so than anything else. I have seen him drop, like, say, KJ Nunes with a head kick, for example. And I believe he beat Cesar Mutanch Ferreira by, what, elbows in close? So he does have a clinch game as well. But mainly his boxing game is what I've been most impressed with as far as the stand-up goes. So it's a good jab and whatnot. His overall Brazilian jiu-jitsu skills are very underrated. This is a guy, don't forget, he did tap out Michael Chiesa. And seeing that Chiesa just chopped out Benil Dariush, that's a pretty, you know, pretty big feather in your cap, you know, at this point, you know, to tap out that guy. And Masvidal's chin is like granite. That guy has a really good chin. This one's really tough for me to call. One thing that's always going to hurt me with Masvidal is, well, Masvidal was pretty big for 155. He doesn't seem particularly big for 170. You know, it's very similar to, like, Benson Henderson. You know, it's like, yeah, you're big for one weight class, but you're not, like, huge for welterweight. And actually, 5'11", you know, like, Larkin's not, you know, height-wise, isn't that tall for a weight class these days. You're seeing a lot of six-footers now at welterweight. Guys as high as, like, 6'3", you know, are actually becoming 6'2", 6'1", to 6'3", are actually becoming more of the norm these days. But Larkin, though, is a guy that is more of a welterweight than Masvidal is, in my opinion. This is interesting because I don't know exactly how the stylized matchup is going to work. If Larkin actually commits to a strong kicking game and a strong leg kicking game, I can definitely see him taking Masvidal here. Hands, I had to favor Masvidal as far as hands go. At range, I tend to favor Lorenz Larkin here. And also, he's just a bit more unorthodox. In my opinion, I think he's just going to be the bigger fighter here. So his hits are probably going to affect Masvidal a little more than Masvidal's hits might affect Larkin. Arguably. So with that said, I am going to go Lorenz Larkin here by decision. Really tough one for me to call. I think it'll be a lot of fun. Larkin's been looking really good at welterweight. I mean, he's beaten Ponzinibbio, who I'm actually pretty high on. You know, he managed to do pretty well against Albert Tumanov, who I'm also pretty high on, and took that third round. I can't recall if Masvidal is good at defending leg kicks as well. I don't remember him defending leg kicks, and Larkin can get a couple of those in. I think that would actually help Larkin in this fight. Diversity, especially at range, I favor Larkin. A little more at boxing range and in the clinch, I will favor Masvidal. So, with that said, yeah, I'll go Lorenz Larkin by decision. So right after that, Josh the People's Warrior Burkman fights Paul the Irish Dragon Felder. Burkman, 28-12 record with 1 no contest, 7 wins by KO TKO, 10 wins by sub. He has 7 lost by submission. 35 years old, he's 5'10", 29 pit elevated. His boxing's good, he's particularly heavy-handed. He's pretty big for 155 as well. His grappling, I mean, his wrestling's not too bad. I'd say it's average overall. Paul Felder, 11-2 record, 7 wins by KO TKO, 1 win by sub, 31 years old, he's 5'10", training out of Hendo Gracie's. Felder's pretty unorthodox, he'll go for a lot of spinning strikes, strong kickboxer, real heavy hands, and actually has a pretty good left hook too, or lead hook. Got a really good chin. His takedown defense is solid, and his overall grappling's improving too. He did win by rear naked choke, in a fight he was losing, against Darren Cruikshank. And I gotta say, Burkman's fight against KJ Nunes was not particularly inspiring. And actually, Burkman's whole run in the UFC has not been particularly inspiring. I think Burkman also was gassing, too. I gotta wonder how much that weight cut affects him. And with that said, I like Felder's game here. I think Felder can... I think he's a better striker than Burkman. He's got a good chin. His overall grappling is improved enough that if Burkman does go for takedowns, I can see Felder defending them. And yeah, I can see Felder beating up Burkman on the feet. Burkman's getting older. His chin did get cracked against Cote. He almost got finished by Lombard as well. And I don't think moving down in weight actually helps chin. So I'm going to go Paul Felder by KO or TKO. I like what I see out of Felder's game. I think when he was fighting some of the guys he's lost to, it was a little too early in his career to fight him. But he fought valiantly against, you know, Pearson. He's pretty experienced. And Barboza, who's a top 10 lightweight. So, you know, Felder's fought some pretty tough guys. Both guys have fought tough guys. But I like Felder, especially at 155. I think, like I said, I really think that weight cut actually does negatively affect Burkman here. And Felder hits hard. He's rolling orthodox. He's good takedown defense. And so, and it's just improving his overall game. Has some good knees, too. I forgot about that. He has good knees, too. So, Paul Felder by KO or TKO. Okay, on to Fox Sports 1 prelims. Jessica Evil Eye fights Sara McMann. Okay, Jessica Eye, 11-4 record with 1 no contest. 3 wins by KO or TKO, 1 win by sub. 29 years old, she's 5'6 on a 2-fight losing streak. Training out of Strong Style Fight Team. Same team as heavyweight champion Stipe Miocic. She's only won one of her last 4 fights. I think that was against Leslie Smith. Her boxing's solid, though. She actually has some pretty good boxing. For the division. Uses combinations pretty well. Her takedown defense is actually pretty good. You know, it's not terrible. It's not impenetrable either, but it's not too bad. And her whole grappling game, you know, it's serviceable. You know, I'd say it's average. You know, like, Juliana Pena had a hard time holding her down when she's, when I was on her back, and whatnot. Sara McMann, 8-3 record, 1 win by TKO, 3 wins by sub, 35 years old, she's 5-5 on a 2-fight losing streak. She only won 1 over her last 4 fights. I think that was against Lauren Murphy. She's an Olympic-level wrestler with strong top control. Her stand-up is actually improving. I really wish McMann would trust her stand-up a little more. You have to remember, when she fought Misha Tate, she dropped her in the first round and broke her orbital bone. You know? Her stand-up is actually not too bad. Chin's not the greatest, though. I have seen her get dropped by Baszler. Nunez dropped her as well. I don't think that'll be a problem here, though. So, and McMann, her losses are to, like, Tate, who's champion, and Nunez, who's fighting for the title. I like McMahon's game overall better here. I like her stand-up. When she does use it, it's actually pretty solid. And she can always rely on her wrestling. One thing I don't like about McMahon's game is that she is something of a lay-and-pray artist. Aside from the Murphy fight, for example. Takedown, top control, very little ground and pound. There's a lot of stuff about McMann it's like I wish she would do more with. Because she seems to have the tools, but doesn't, or like the ability, but doesn't seem to want to use it. It's like I wish she'd posture up more and rain more ground and pound instead of just being a blanket, you know? That's not just the Murphy fight, too. That's other fights I've seen of hers. Jessica Eye, though, like I said, she's not bad standing. She might even get the better of McMahon standing. Might be able to defend the takedowns. So, that one's pretty close. I think this is a good matchup, but overall, I like Sara McMann here to win by decision. I think she can mix up her wrestling and her striking just enough to get that win. Next fight, I thought Abel, Killa Trujillo fights Jordan Alde Rinaldi. Rinaldi, 12-4 record, 1-1 by TKO, 7 wins by sub, 28 years old. He's 5'10", training or on a 5-fight win streak. It's his first fight in the UFC and states his fight on short notice. His Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills are really strong, both on top and on the ground. His stand-up, that was just average. To this day, I probably still can't really forget James Mutashri just knocking him out cold. I guess stand-up's just average at best. You know, he's not particularly heavy-handed. It's kind of like a tool to use to try and get a takedown. Abel Trujillo, 14-6 record with 1-0 contest, 5 wins by KO TKO, 4 wins by sub. Also has 3 losses by submission, 32 years old, he's 5'8", training out of Black Zillions. His stand-up's actually pretty good, except that he rushes in a lot, and that, like, before the guillotine, I mean, he was just getting, like tagged on the way in by Tony Sims. But he's really heavy-handed, he actually uses knees well from in close and whatnot. His overall wrestling game actually isn't too bad. His cardio, though, sucks. I mean, the guy's pretty much a one-round fighter, you know? And he fades as the fight goes on. That's the only things working against Trujillo here, really. I think Rinaldi's probably better on the ground, and maybe if he can survive, whether they already storm, get the fight to the ground, eventually get the sub. But he's not a threat standing, and Trujillo's pretty much a Hulk. I mean, that guy is like huge for the weight class, and I can see him just bullying Rinaldi around, getting the better stand up, and eventually probably just dropping him, you know, and getting the KO or TKO finish. So I'm gonna go Abel Trujillo to win this by KO or TKO. I don't think Rinaldi has a stand up to really make Trujillo respect him, and I don't know if Rinaldi necessarily has the ability to get the fight to the ground, especially early. Maybe later, but not early. I can't really see Rinaldi get the fight to the ground. So, and it doesn't help that he's staying to fight on short notice. So, Abel Trujillo, KO, or TKO. So, after that, Jake Collier fights Alberto Pereira Uda. Uda, 9-0, undefeated record. 4 wins by KO, TKO. 4 wins by sub. 31 years old. He's 6'3", and it's his first fight in the UFC. I watched his most previous fight of his. I really like this guy's clinch striking. I mean, that's really, like, his biggest strength. He has good knees off the clinch. He controls that position really well. And from what I've seen, too, he's actually pretty good off his back, too. I don't know if I'll work really well in the UFC, but, you know, he does have a decent game off his back. Jake Collier, 9-3 record, 4 wins by KO TKO, 3 wins by sub. He also has 2 losses by KO TKO. 27 years old, he's 6'3", trading losses and wins. Collier has, like, this... It's not a highly technical game. Like, his stand-up can get really reckless. When he fought Dong Yang, I mean, he was, like, throwing certain strikes that was getting him off balance, and then he got himself finished in that fight. His overall wrestling game actually isn't too bad. And really, the thing with Collier is that he's just really reckless everywhere. He doesn't really have a clean MMA game. You know, he's not a clean striker. He's not a clean grappler. It's kind of an amalgamation of parts of an MMA game that isn't particularly technical. And with that said, I gotta go with Alberto Uda to win by KO or TKO. It's just that Collier leaves just way too many openings, standing, that I can see him get hit. Collier's just a bit too reckless. And while maybe he can get the fight to the ground, Uda didn't seem like the type, from what I saw at least, to have particularly bad takedown defense either. He actually looked pretty good there too. He was up against a cage from the fights I saw from him. Didn't get taken down so particularly easily. So yeah, I'll go Alberto Uda by KO or TKO. Next fight after that, Erik Newbreed Koch fights Shane Shallon Campbell. These guys are pretty similar actually. Campbell, 12-4 record, 5 wins by KO or TKO, 2 wins by sub, 28 years old, he's 6 foot, trading losses and wins. Name of his game is actually his Muay Thai. But his grappling is actually improving too. He's also proven to just be really tough. When he fought James Cross in the last fight, he got his back taken, but was always scrambled back to his feet. He fought Silverio, defended his takedowns quite well. So overall grappling game, both offensively and defensively, has been improving. And then he has a pretty good stand-up game as well. Erik Koch, 14-4 record, 4 wins by KO TKO, 7 wins by sub. He has 2 losses by KO TKO, 27 years old, he's 5'10", training out of Rufus Sport. He's only won 1 of the last 4 fights, and last fought in May of 2014. That was his loss against Darren Cruikshank. Koch, he's a good kickboxer, actually, himself. He uses combinations well. His defense in the stand-up does need some work, though. And his overall grappling game, takedown defense is actually good. And he's actually pretty good on the ground, too. This one's actually hard for me to call because I can't really see how good or not good Erik Koch is at lightweight. I mean, he did lose to Derek Cruikshank in his last fight. But, you know, Shane Campbell, I don't think he has that level of kicking game that Darren Cruikshank has. Oh, this one's actually really tough for me to call. No, think about it. I was actually leaning towards Koch here, but I kind of like Campbell's game. I like the improvements he's making. Koch is something of the forgotten man of the division, too. You know, he moved up from 145. I think he won against, Tractor, and then lost against Cruikshank or something like that. Size-wise, Campbell should be the bigger fighter. I am now rethinking this fight because they're both very similar. I can't really see one guy getting the better of the other, per se, in any one area of the game. Wow. That layoff, too, doesn't look too good on Erik Koch's part. You know what? As I originally go Erik Koch, I'm actually changing my pick now. I like Shane Campbell's game. I like his game just a little better here. I'm going to go Erik Campbell by decision. Tough guy. He's been fighting more consistently. He looks to be improving despite losing and winning. Shane Campbell looks like a guy who's constantly improving, especially his grappling. Stand-ups always been pretty solid. I mean, he got knocked out by, John McDassey. And McDassey's, standing's really good. Not to say that Koch's stand-up's really good, too, you know. It's not like he can't get good punches on Campbell or anything like that. I think the height difference might play a factor here, too. Real interesting, man. And that layoff. I just can't ignore the layoff. Shane Campbell, by decision. Not one I'm confident in. Like I said, I was originally going to go with Erik Koch, but I just can't ignore some of the stuff that I'm seeing out of Shane Campbell at this point and then the improvements that he's made. Okay, on to the prelims. Bryan, Kid Lightning, Caraway fights Aljamain Funkmaster Sterling. Sterling, 12-0, undefeated record, 2 wins by KO TKO, 6 wins by sub, 26 years old, he's 5'7", training out of Cerro Longo. He's a strong wrestler, particularly strong Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills, really good front choke series, for example. His stand-up is a work in progress, though. It's real kick-heavy. It's mainly range kicking, you know. Bryan Caraway, 20-7 record, 1 win by TKO, 17 wins by sub. He has 2 losses by submission. 31 years old, he's 5'9", training out of Extreme Couture. He has some strong Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills, particularly strong back control and particularly strong front chokes as well. His takedowns against a cage are really good. He's not the greatest at takedowns, in the center of the cage, but against the cage, he's always been really good there. His stand-up is average, but surprisingly, he was outboxing Wineland in his last fight. You know, it wasn't pretty, but it worked. And Caraway has a really strong chin, too. Like I said, this is actually a really tough stylistic matchup for Sterling. I'd imagine he's a favorite here, and for good reason. He's probably the better athlete here. He's a good wrestler himself and constantly improving. But the ways he tends to win, I mean, it's with his wrestling and his overall grappling skills. The only problem is Caraway is a good wrestler and grappler himself. The difference here, in my opinion, would probably be athleticism. I like Sterling's overall athleticism here. He has that kick-heavy stand-up. I don't know how Caraway does against it. Caraway's stand-up isn't anything great, but it's enough for him to win. You had to fight relatively smart to beat Caraway. This one's tough for me to call, to be honest with you. You know, Sterling's the easy choice, but it's not a great stylistic matchup for him. But, like, I can't really see Caraway really imposing his game that well on Sterling as well. You know, I can't really see him getting takedowns on him. I don't know if he'll necessarily outbox him either. So, I'm going to go Aljamain Sterling. I think Sterling, like I said, a bit more athletic, so that means I can see him get the takedown. I think he's more likely to get the takedown in Caraway than Caraway is to get it on Sterling. And at the very least, even though he has a kick-heavy stand-up game, should be enough to at least keep Caraway at range or make it kind of hard on Caraway to work his overall stand-up game. Tough one for me to call. Aljamain Sterling by decision. And finally, at heavyweight, Chris De La Rocha fights Adam, the prototype Milstead. Okay, or is it Rocha? I'll say Rocha. Chris De La Rocha, 4-1 record, 2 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub. He has 1 loss by TKO. He's 6-3, and he's never been past the second round. He lost to that one dude with the heavyweight. He's not even a big heavyweight. Who has that really long name? I forgot now. Okay, well, anyways. De La Rocha, you know, his wrestling, everything about him is just kind of average. You know, he's really raw, too. His wrestling game, he can wrestle. His stand-up's average at best. Not a bad boxer. Defensively, not the greatest. Adam Mills says, 7-1 record, 5 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub. He has 1 loss by TKO, 28 years old. He's 6-3 on a 7-fight win streak. It's his first fight in the UFC, and he's never been past the second round. So I watched some, like, one of his fights. He mainly strikes in the pocket. He just goes in the pocket and kind of throws. He's not even a range striker. The problem with that, though, is his defense looks pretty bad. I'll say this right now. He is really fit for the weight class. He seems really strong. He looks like a another Todd Duffy. Not just built, you know? Sculpted body, pretty much, you know? And Milstead does have a wrestling background, too. With that said, I'll go Adam Milstead by KO or TKO to win this one. Okay, to recap, I have Tomas Almeida over Cody Garbrandt by decision. Jeremy Stevens beating Renan Barão by KO or TKO. Tarec Saffiedine over Rick Story by decision. Vitor Miranda beating Chris Camozzi, I believe, by decision with a possible KO or TKO. Lorenz Larkin over Jorge Masvidal by decision. Paul Felder beating Josh Burkman by KO or TKO. On the prelims, I have Sara McMann over Jessica I by decision. Abel Trujillo over Jordan Rinaldi by KO or TKO. Alberto Uda, Pereira Uda over Jake Collier by KO or TKO. And Shane Campbell beating Erik Koch by decision. On the prelims, of Aljamain Sterling over Bryan Caraway by decision. And Adam Milstead beating Chris De La Rocha by KO or TKO. So that's it for my predictions for UFC Fight Night 88, Almeida versus Garbrandt. Please leave any comments below. And please check out UFC Betting Sharks on Facebook. Like the page. if you're interested in joining group interview with Mitch Williams. Also, please support me in my journey of being an author by buying my first novel, a fantasy adventure called The Mustard Prince in the Condiment Kingdom, for $8.95 at www.chrismaldonado.com, and also find it at amazon.com as well. So that's it for my predictions for UFC Fight Night 88, and that's it for MMA for You. Thank you guys very much.